Okay guys, so we are here going up the escalator. We just got here to CES. Just got our passes. It wasn't as warm. In fact, it was kind of cold and outside to get our passes this year. We're going straight to the Quantum Conference.
Okay.
So what are the investment signals? What would trigger investment in quantum?
I'm here with Dr. Joseph Rose, Vice President of IBM Quantum.
IBM Quantum.
And he is going to share with us the one sentence that he sees different about quantum this year as opposed to last year.
Things are progressing exponentially faster, where we expect that in 2026, there will be a demonstrable quantum advantage where these results are verifiably superior to either quantum computing or classical alone operating in a hybrid mode.
And that is leaps and bounds to what we saw last year. So this is super exciting.
It's really an exponential increase.
The show will begin
Thank you.
In
Appreciate
1 minute.
It.
We have Ariel Bronstein, Chief Product Officer from IonQ. We have Pooya Dianat, the Chief Revenue Officer from Quantum Computing, Inc., and Joe Bros from IBM.
Well, first, survey after survey has shown that about 80% of CEOs globally feel that quantum computing is going to impact their business, and therefore they feel that they should get ready. When you go further in the survey and ask them, how many of you are ready? Only about 40% at this point feel that they are quantum ready. So what is what caused them to make that decision? What caused them to go ahead and invest? First, it ultimately has to come down to value. They see something in quantum computing that is going to bring value to their organization, value to their business. There is some sort of computational intensity in their workflow as an organization that is going to benefit from using quantum computing, or more importantly, hybrid computing, classical high-performance compute combined with quantum. So they see something in the workflow for their organization where they see a rate of return, they see incipient value, emerging value, or somehow better, faster, cheaper, or the value could be that they can simply approach a problem now that they couldn't approach previously without quantum.
I can go next. So what I observe in interaction with our customers is I see the switch flips when we actually show real value for them today. If you want to, there is a perception in general that universal quantum computing is for the future, and there is still time for people to take action on it, and they would take the appropriate action at the right time. But what we do differently at QCI is we demonstrate value today. And that is intentional. Our application-specific quantum computers can bring value and solve really difficult math problems or industrial math problems today. And when we demonstrate that to our customers, even at the scale that it is today, that's the time that we see the switch flips. For instance, I can give you an example. We have a customer in the realm of finance, and we have had demos of it later at CES as well, that once we started showing that we can show better results, for instance, in portfolio optimization and management, that's the time that all the decision makers in that specific vertical got involved, and we are pushing on that front. So our approach for this, for people, is that if you don't get on the quantum right now, you will lose your competitive edge right in the next few years, and that's going to be too late because someone else is going to eat your lunch. So you'd better get involved right now, and we can demonstrate the value to you today.
So I would say that my answer spread between computing, networking, and sensing. And each one is a different level of maturity and readiness. So on networking side, I'd say, and they're all interconnected. So due to the progress in computing, quantum networking is becoming a critical part of the security posture the company needs to have. And I know there are debates within the industry about when is Q day, meaning the day that quantum will be able to decrypt a sort of RSA encryption. And we have taken the most aggressive of the positions, which is due to our roadmap, which, as a public company, we have to sort of be very forthcoming about these things. We believe that it is much, much sooner than what everybody expects, which means that corporations around the world are going to be caught flat-footed, where their infrastructure is not ready. On the computing side, I'd say that one of the things that are critical is to understand that everybody is looking to deliver value right now. There are different modalities. Each of us represent a different modality in quantum computing, and they mature at different rates. So you see, we have three representatives here who are delivering value right now, but that's because of the modality. There are other modalities that simply cannot, so they're focusing more on the future. Right? So we're here to do these things, and I would say to all of you, think about AI 2 years ago, right? Think about sort of the moments in which, like, I see some early things, but I'm not sure how it's relevant to me. But the exponential growth that came right after was staggering, and the same thing is going to repeat itself. So don't get flat-footed, because this is coming, and you have to really engage and understand, are you an early adopter? Are you a fast follower? Are you a late follower? That's okay. Any one of these positions is okay. Just know that if you want to be at the forefront of this, you have to take action now.
But to the final user, it really doesn't matter to them whether they are using a calculator, whether they are using an abacus, or whether they are using a hybrid quantum approach. It's the value that they get out of it that matters. And we have to show that to them right now, and that helps them with the adoption. Once we do that, then that's the time that the critical mass is made within that organization, and they jump on it right now. And like I said before, for the ones who don't adopt it, or for the ones who get a more conservative approach, they are going to miss out on the potential revenue or potential profit for future. And the thing about the quantum industry is that if you wait, it's not like the kind of industry that you can find people who understand quantum just walking in the street.
Right.
So you need to build the workforce for it as well, even for the final users. You need to have the right data scientists, you need to have the right people understanding it to be able to deploy it within their ecosystem. For the people who are adopting it today, they are ready for their whole operation system to deploy it tomorrow. For the ones who are late, sorry, it's not going to work out that big.
I think it's important to talk about this value creation. People that are aggressively pursuing the companies, the organizations, the 300 of them that are in our network today, you know, 50 or so of them are large nameplate businesses. The reason that they're going after it is that they see that they can get inside their competitors' OODA loop. They're going to be able to approach the market and make decisions that'll be meaningful to their shareholders faster. And in addition, they'll be able to do that more effectively using an advanced computational method. As Priya just said, it doesn't really matter whether it's a quantum computer or an abacus, but if it gives them some sort of a competitive advantage where over their competitors in the marketplace that they serve, you will see them now aggressively moving toward quantum computing.
So one of the things I noticed is that all of these quantum conversations were actually relating fairly heavily to the financial industry, and most companies were not even thinking about financials last year, but you saw Wells Fargo, JP Morgan, and other financial industry companies at the conference looking for how quantum's going to impact asset analysis. And that fact lit a fire under me, because this last year, we've been integrating quantum into our analysis for stock analysis. And I didn't include it in the video, but I actually got to talk with the head of quantum at IBM, and he really liked the idea for this app that we've been developing over the last year, particularly because not only do we allow users to have the best AI models in the world, from OpenAI to Claude, Gemini, and Grok, but you gain access to the ability to look at the projections from those different AI models and then run those projections through companies like the ones at this conference, IonQ or Rigetti. In fact, I can run an IonQ analysis right now. It's going to use quantum analysis to find which time frame projection
is the most accurate according to the quantum computers. And you can see the confidence here from quantum. IonQ is at 67%. That, for example, NVIDIA is going to sell down over the next week by about 1.8%. And this is very dynamic. It's experimental, and we're still getting results right now to measure and see how the value can impact portfolios. And if you want to get on the first access list for this tool, it's the first link in the description below to access Prophecy AI. But as investors, you might be wondering, well, how much is quantum going to be growing over the next year? And based on what we heard from this conference, big companies that weren't previously involved in the quantum space have become involved this year in order to integrate quantum computing into their companies. In simple terms, this means that any company that is a quantum company most likely will see increased revenues, increased engagement, and integration over the next year, which will drive the quantum market to new levels from now until 2030. But the key is that they're already integrating with GPUs right now.
Value from quantum computing is sort of hiding in plain sight everywhere throughout your organization. It's not yet packaged in a way that you know, oh, this is the solution for X and I do X, therefore I need this. It's much more about the process of discovery, evaluating your entire set of challenges in the business. And what you're looking for are signs of computationally heavy, but highly valuable. So small improvements, not to mention large improvements, are worth the effort of exploring it. Quantum is different enough that you can't just take your team of engineers and say, oh, just run your C code on quantum. It doesn't work that way. It's a big transition. It's a worthy transition, but it's not a simple one. Therefore, identifying these bottlenecks and then applying the right partnerships, each one of us do that with our customers day in, day out, identifying these bottlenecks and working through it with each of any of our customers. Because without it, we do not understand your domain. And you don't understand, or depending on who you are in this audience, right, could be from the quantum industry, but customers do not understand quantum, and we don't understand their domain. It's that meeting of the mind that makes magic at this stage of the industry.
There's a cycle where the CTO, the CEO makes a decision, let's go. The CTO starts and builds a small team. That small team then takes a look at the workflow, evaluates how could the business perhaps benefit from quantum computing. After that evaluation period, then a slightly larger team is built, and that's where workforce issues start to become really important. Superconducting qubits is what IBM specializes in, and it is our qubit of choice, along with other competitors, Google and Rigetti, and others, IQM in Europe. Superconducting qubits offer a gate speed advantage. So what that allows is a tremendous circuit depth. It's not only the number of qubits that's important, but it's also how long those qubits can cohere and how deep a circuit can be run on that quantum computer. And that is the determinant for useful applications. Because fault tolerance, error correction, all have a qubit overhead. The number of qubits is important, but having those deep circuits over 5, 10, 15,000 depth, two qubit gate circuits is extraordinarily important. So we see our advantage as we move into this quantum advantage era. And our utility, which I think has already been established in the industry, as having more qubits that run deeper and deeper circuits.
At Quantum Computing Inc., we have selected photonics as a way of doing the quantum computing. And like I said, our technology is newest. We define our qubits in the time domain as opposed to spatial domain. The reason that is important is that it gives us the possibility to get large number of qubits that are less prone to noise and in a scalable fashion. For instance, on a photonic integrated circuit chip, like what happened in microelectronics, it can happen in photonics that on a single small chip, you can get functionality of quantum computing and you can deploy them at scale. So you can make like millions or billions of these chips and deploy them to your regular daily mobile devices or anything like that as a QPU unit that would basically be integrated with the GPU and CPUs and make a new high performance compute modality. So that is fundamentally different from some of other technologies that you see, that at the end of it, because they, the way they define the qubits, they are going to end up with a very large interconnected size of this room or a building size, one unit quantum computer that is not scalable, and that limits the business model into B2B. Our approach would enables us to go to B2B2C or maybe even someday B2C. So that's what makes quantum computing and our technology different, because it's practical and it's scalable. It can be deployed in millions and millions.
It's funny, you're being exposed right now to like the marketing war between between all three companies. They say the same things with the exactly same claims, only I am right.
So that's why I jumped in first.
And I have the closing word, you see? So I'd say, overall, trapped ion is one of the modalities. We have chosen a path that allows us to get to simply larger scale faster than anybody else, therefore get to full tolerance. We hold the record in the highest quality fidelity of 2-qubit gates in the world, and our roadmap, public roadmap, is we're going to get to 10,000 physical qubits in 2 years. We're committed to 80,000 physical qubits within 5 years. This is well ahead of the rest of the industry, not to mention the longest coherence time and the highest fidelity logical qubit. So a lot of differences underneath the hood. The question is how it's being interpreted and what we do with it. It is a very frustrating field because our messaging is confusing every single person here. But at the same time, come and talk to us, right? The way to get yourself out of that confusion is come and talk to us. That's the only way.
And if I might add,
well, he wants the last word.
On a neutral basis, there is a website that's been put up in GitHub called Quantum Advantage Tracker. Take a look at it. People are posting from any company, and it can be from any one of the competitors, those use cases where they're starting to see advantage. First ones were posted in November. There were a bunch posted over the holiday. Quantum Advantage Tracker, and it's on GitHub. Take a look. It's very interesting to see this emerge now. And you can see the various qubit modalities, the various algorithms, and the use cases where people are really pushing it. Was that neutral? Okay.